My name is Vicki Schorsch. I'm going to be interviewing, along with Bill Allen, our cameraman, Mr. Richard Padilla, Vietnam War veteran. Mr. Padilla, let's start with where you were born and when.
I was born in Montebello, California, 1950, February 28th.
And what were your parents' occupations? What did they do?
My mom was a homemaker. My dad was a car salesman for a long time.
Any brothers and sisters?
I have three sisters and two brothers. The one passed away just last year.
Older, younger?
Older brother, yeah.
Did your brother serve in the military?
My oldest brother served in the Army. He was in Germany, Frankfurt.
And, yeah. But he didn't go to Vietnam?
He tried to, so I wouldn't go, but didn't work.
I see. All right. What were you doing before you entered the service?
I made F-15 canopy jet windows for a little bit. At that time, you know, the draft was on, and half my class had already gotten their draft notices because somewhere along the way they flunked somewhere. And by the time they graduated, they were off in the military. And I was waiting for my number to come up, you know, watching the lottery and the TV every night. My number just wasn't coming up. And everybody in my class had already gone, and they're serving. And I told my dad, who was in World War II, and my uncle's in Korea, I told him, you know, Dad, I'm tired of waiting. I know I'm going. I'm going to volunteer because I want to do my time, you know. I know it's going to go. So I went ahead and volunteered. And I took off and ended off at the LA reception center where they send you off to whatever, you know, place you're going to go. But at that time, they were doing, they put you in a line and they were going Army, Navy, Marines, Air Force. I want to be Army. And, you know, they were doing this. And that, what they said you were, you got on a line, you took off. And I was going as fast as I could, counting to the Army, Navy, and it's Marines, Army. And the guy behind me said, I told him, hey, do you want to be a Marine? He said, yes. I grabbed him. As soon as I grabbed him, threw him in front of me. That sergeant came up, Marine, Army. I said, thank you, Lord. And off to Fort Ord I went.
That's a pretty
that was the beginning of my thing. I got drafted a week later when I was in basic training. Mom, I called my mom. She said, hey, you got your draft notice. I said, wow, funny. I'm in already.
Now, what made you choose Army? Why did you want to do that so badly?
My dad was in the Army. My brother was in the Army. My uncles were in the Army. And I said, I'll just follow tradition, you know, Army.
So where were you at basic training? What was that like?
Tough. It's right on the beach, Fort Ord. It's not there anymore. They already tore it out. A lot of sand. Running up and down hills in sand is horrible. And with a full pack, you start building muscles really quick in your legs, which I needed, thank God, because Nam was the same way, up and down mountains all the time.
Do you remember anything about basic training, the instructors you had, or any experiences there?
Yeah, the first 2 weeks, the instructors were looking at us all, and they needed assistant sergeants on the basic trainees, and they saw I had some kind of ability. They made me acting sergeant for the platoon, so I was able to, you know, lead the guys, you know. And plus, they gave me my own room, which was fantastic. And Fort Ord, they had that meningitis or something that was going on, and all the windows had to stay open. And it got really cold along the coast. I had a heater in my own room, so I just enjoyed it.
So, how did you feel like you adapted to military life?
At first, it was hard, you know, just getting conditioned. You know, getting up in the morning, running 2 miles. And doing exercises and stuff and running everywhere you go. It got kind of hard in the beginning. Yeah, but after a while, I liked it. I liked the food. I enjoyed the food, yeah. I hated KP, but I liked the food.
Now, when did you arrive in Vietnam?
I arrived in Vietnam in 1970, June, early part of June, midway June. Can't remember exact date, but it was June of 70.
And what happened when you got there? Did you arrive with a bunch of other GIs? Were you?
I arrived there with a bunch of the same as me, you know, drafted, got drafted and sent to Nam. As soon as they landed in Da Nang, I was like the third one out the door. And as soon as I hit the door, and the smell was different. And it was hot. I'm going, oh my God, is this what we're going to do? This is the way it's going to be all the time? Well, I found out. I was there in Da Nang for 6 days. And on the sixth day, the day that they were going to take me to this Kwanzaa hut where they send you to your units to let you know where they're going, mm-hmm. Da Nang got rocketed with 122 rockets. And I got a slight little sliver of shrapnel from that on my back shoulder. And I received a Purple Heart there. I said, oh boy, I'm going home. There's only 6 days in country and I'm out of here. One stitch and off a bag. And they told me I was with the 101st Airborne where I was going.
So you're just right out there from that?
Yeah, I just put a stitch and Band-Aid and off I went.
So what kind of friendships did you make out in Vietnam?
Real tight. Especially with my squad. We depended on each other. I had their back, they had mine. I know these guys better than my own brothers. You know, and I've never forgotten it. That's the only thing I really got out of Vietnam is the friendship that I received from all these guys.
Now had you traveled much before you went there? Was it different to kind of be thrust together with a bunch of guys from all over the country? Was there an adjustment to that, or anything?
What do you mean by travel in country?
Well, no, I mean like in the United States. Like, had you met a lot of people from outside of where you grew up? Was it different to kind of be with guys from the big city or guys from small southern towns?
Yeah, it was a little different. Meeting guys from back east and stuff, and you know, every time I come back east, it's like I'm talking to foreigners. You know, you guys talk plain English. I make fun. They make fun of me.
What'd you do for like fun when you had an opportunity to have fun? I'm sure.
I love to fish and hunt, and I do that today.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
Were you able to do that out there?
We use grenades and rivers to get.
They do?
When we run out of sea, we're running out of food. Throw a grenade in a river, and hopefully some fish come up.
Now, when you were out in the field, what would a typical day be like out there?
Humping. I carried an M60 machine gun and a heavy, heavy pack, especially during the summer. You carry 8 quarts of water. I carried almost 2,000 rounds of ammo, 3 grenades, a pound of C4, my writing material in an ammo can that we kept because the only thing that kept it dry, and one blanket, which is in nylon, because you don't need blankets there. I mean, you get soaked, you get under a cover, you'd be steaming. You'd be dry within a half hour.
What would you say was the hardest part of that day-to-day aspect of life in Vietnam?
The worst? I would say not knowing, you know, and humping all the time, always on the move. And being in Central Highlands, that meant up and down mountains all the time. Yeah. And during the monsoon, it was crazy wet. All the time, you're always wet, always, you know, your clothes are always wet. And sliding, going up, first 2 guys going up the mountain, it's fine, they got nice grip, but from then on, it gets worse and worse. Oh, I could tell you stories how some of the guys would laugh, because one day I was going up, I was in front of Jim Zewett, Mike Allen, and a couple of other guys, and I slipped. And we were resupplied, I think, the day before, so our packs were really heavy. And I carried the M60 machine gun. That's it. And I had it over my shoulder. I went back, and I started rolling down the hill. I mean, I'm bouncing everywhere, and the guy just let me go. Well, I don't blame him, because, you know, if I would have hit one of them, it would have been daisy chain. One guy would have been hit down until they got to where to stop. But the worst part was I jammed my machine gun right into the mud. No cleaning kits. They never supplied us with any kind of cleaning kits. I mean, we just wash them out with a canteen. I mean, I blew down the barrel and I couldn't push air through it. So all night long, I'm working with a branch I cut off a bush trying to get that barrel clean. And finally got it clean after pouring water down it. And oh, that was a bad experience.
How'd you stay in touch with any family or friends while you were over there?
By mail. Off and on, the chopper come in, pick up, we could write on anything and it'll get to our parents. I would write to only my brothers, my parents, and one aunt who was always writing to me.
Did you tell them how it was, or was did you kind of?
My dad, I would tell him most, well, I would write him separately and mail it to where he worked, so my mom don't get it. And I would tell him what's going on. My mom was too worried. She was her nerves were shot knowing that I was there. You know, so.
And was your brother in Germany at the time?
Yeah, he tried going to Vietnam for it so I wouldn't have to go, but they just wouldn't let him do it. So.
And was he career military? Did he stay?
No, ma'am. No. He, same as me. He got drafted 2 years. Yeah.
So you had that injury, that slight injury when you were first arrived. Tell me what other firefights or encounters you had with the enemy while you were over there.
Mostly there were hit and runs, you know, and just two that were decent battles. But the last time was the worst, April 14th. Yeah. And that was the worst.
That was in 1971?
Yeah, 1971. Well, we got hit really bad and we lost all the guys. And I got shrapnel from a B-40 rocket. It's an RPG round. And my leg blew a hole in my leg. And actually, I was also shot in my leg, and I never knew it till the doctor was operating on me. I was awake when they were cutting me, and he found a bullet right near below where the shrapnel was. I said, "Did you know you were shot?" I said, "No." I says, "I was behind a tree. Shooting, and all this, the tree splinters were flying everywhere because they were hitting the tree, but I never felt anything hit me. I had so much adrenaline going through my body, you know, I didn't feel anything. But a few hours later, that's when I got hit, and that was it for me. I couldn't feel my whole right side of my body. I thought I lost my leg. I was too scared to look because every time I move, I was being shot at. So I waited till a flare, all the flares went off, and I decided I'll roll on my back and I got to see what's going on because there's nobody around me. And I thought maybe my leg was, that's it. I didn't have no feeling. So I ran my right hand down my right leg and I got halfway down. Then my hand went down into my leg and I thought, oh God, I got a hole in my leg. And it says, now I said, I have to look because I might have lost my leg. I said, so the flare went off and I just bent over just a slight. I didn't want to get moved much. And I felt my knee and I said, oh, I saw my foot. I said, oh, good. Everything's there. I just have a hole in my leg. But I was bleeding quite bad. And then I had a Vietnamese scout saw me go down. And he came over and put a tourniquet on my leg, told me he would be back for me because he was too small to drag me. I was, So I waited. Nothing happened. He never came. Apparently he got wounded on the way back. So I waited to the point I said, I was really scared. So I said, I got to get out of here. I might be bleeding to death. I don't even know it. So I happened to have a Randall knife that I carried, and everybody used to use it for, you know, to cut palm leaves and stuff, just throw on the ground so you could sleep on them. And I started digging it into the ground and dragging myself away until I got to the slog where there was two heads. And I said, oh, my God, I crawled myself into the enemy. I said, and I looked over after I got on the log. I saw it was two of our guys. And they dragged me over the log and dragged me over to where all the wounded and dead were. And I spent a day there lying next to the guys. And had one poor guy, McKinney, who half his face was blown off and his left foot was blown off. It was still there, but it was just hanging. And I was talking to him throughout the night, and he kept telling me that he didn't want to go home like this all night. And next morning, medic came up to me and says, "Richard Simon," said, "we're going to take you out." I said, "Don't take me, take McKinney." He's worse. I look at him. And he tells him, "No, McKinney going out, he's dead." I said, "No," I said, "they had tourniquet on him. He was fine. He wasn't bleeding." I said, "He died of shock." Wow. I said, "Oh my God." So they got me out with two other wounded. There were guys that were shot in the arm. They put us on a penetrator. Do you know what a penetrator is?
Don't tell us about that.
It's like a hook that comes out. It opens up with three seats. And what you do, you sit on them, and they take you up through the jungle. There's no seat belts, nothing. You just hold on for dear life. Well, the two guys that they put with me to go up the penetrator were both shot in the arm. One guy was shot in the left arm. The other guy was shot in the right. And they were telling me that they can't hold on. And they have to hold on to the penetrator to not fall off. And I told him, I'll tell you what I do. I'm okay. I said, oh, it's just my leg. I told him, what I'm going to do, the guy on my left said, "Look, I'm going to grab you. I'm going to put my right arm around the penetrator. I'm going to grab your shoulder. I'm going to hold you." And the guy on my right, I told him, I'll put my left arm around, grabbed his shoulder. And I told him, "I'm going to hold you." I says, "With your good arms, hold on to me." And up we went. But as soon as we got past the tree lines, the helicopter, it was getting hit. We were being shot on the way up. And you could hear the bullets hitting the medevac. And as soon as he saw that we cleared the trees, he took off. And I'm telling you, we were up on a high mountain at the time. And when he took off, we're dangling like this. The cable's like this, and we're hanging, and we're flying through the air.
How'd you hang out with those guys?
As tight as I could. I mean, I was scared, crazy scared. Because, I felt like I was going to fall off too. Because, yeah. I mean, we're dangling and we're at an angle and that helicopter is moving. He wanted out of there. And so did we, but him more than us. He didn't care what was going on below him. They finally got us up and got into the helicopter, and I apparently was the first one in because they brought the penetrator in. I fell on my back. Penetrator fell on me. The other two guys fell on me on my leg. And I said, ouch.
Yeah.
Then I end up in Cameron Bay Hospital. And our lieutenant that was out in the field with us got a job in camp. He was there to meet us, and he helped me out of the helicopter and took me into the hospital.
Which lieutenant was that?
Pardon me?
Which lieutenant was that?
Lieutenant Baker.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. We had Lieutenant Humphrey at the time when he got hit. He was the new lieutenant we had. Yeah.
So how long did you spend in the hospital? How long was your recovery?
I spent about a month in the hospital. I was in Cameron Bay, then they shimmied to Da Nang. They weren't able to close my wound after they took all the flesh that was torn up. And they left my wound open. In Da Nang, I had a nurse cleaning my wound out, and she was talking to one of my friends to my left side, and she was basting me with like a turkey base, those plungers.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that's what she was getting the stuff and pouring on my leg, cleaning up my leg out. Well, she was talking, she was doing it, and she ended up hitting my flesh and my leg. And when she released it, it took the flesh into me. I hit her. I mean, I never felt so much pain. It was worse than when I got hit. I mean, I just hit her across the chest, knocked her down, crying. Then I have a captain come in. He says, I have a nurse that wants to file court charges against you for hitting her. I said, sir, I said, look, I'm really sorry about that. I said, I didn't mean to hit her, but it was just a gut reaction to get her away from me. I said, what she did, it caused me a lot of pain. And I showed him, because she walked up and left my wound open, and and I said, and he looked, and he says, oh my God, she could see where she sucked my flesh, and my leg was starting to swell up from it. And he said, I'll be back in a minute. And so he was out. About a half hour, and came back with a nurse, and she apologized to me. But I said, no, you don't need to apologize. I'm sorry. I said, I hit you, but, you know, it was just a gut reaction. I said, I apologize. I'm sorry I hit you. But she said she was sorry, and I told her she was sorry. I was sorry, and we became pretty good friends there. She used to bring me in desserts, extra desserts, and until they shipped me to Da Nang. You know, well, that wasn't Da Nang until they shipped me to Japan.
So did you head home after that?
No, ma'am. The doctor in Japan, they finally sewed me up, but my stitches broke open twice because it was too tight, and anytime I moved, it split open my stitches. I stayed in Japan, and they were going to send me stateside. I talked to the lieutenant, captain there, and he says, am I going to have to spend any more time in the military when I get home? And he looked at my record, said, probably several months. I said, sir, I just want out, you know. I don't want anything else to do with the military. I had some great friends and everything, and I miss them. We lost some. I just want to go home. I don't want to spend any more time. I said, well, there's one thing I could do for you. He said, I could send you back to Nam. I said, well, sir, I don't want to go back in the field. You know, I'm too short. He said, no, we'll send you to Fubai, and we'll leave you in the hospital there. I said, okay, I could do that. I said, to get out early is fine. I was sent back to Fubai. I was there for about 2.5 weeks, and I got my early out. And I got to come home.
So what was it like coming home?
Coming home was one of the happiest days of my life. I got to Washington, and the plane landed, and the first thing the pilot says, whatever you do, don't listen to the crowds at the fence. You're demonstrators. Mm-hmm. And I says, okay, that's fine. I said, you might be throwing stuff at you. And as soon as I got off the plane, I dropped to my knees and I kissed the ground. And off I went to the building where they brought us in. And there they told us not to wear uniforms home. I go, well, no. He says, I fought and bled for this country. He says, I'm proud of my military time. He says, I'm going to wear my uniform, you know, home. And I did. And protesters again protested me on the way out. I got to the airport, got a flight home to L.A., and I sat next to this one woman. And she called me a baby killer. Oh, gee. She was apparently a protester or something. She just didn't care. And, oh, my God, I lost my temper big time. And I made her cry. And the things I was telling her, you know, why do you tell me, you know, I'm a baby killer. Says, I did what I had to do, you know. It wasn't my choice. Well, I volunteered, but it wasn't my choice to do what I had to do, you know. And stewardesses came, and they took me away, put me on first class, and they were apologizing for her. I said, I'm sorry that happened to you. You don't deserve to do anything like this, you know, when you're just getting home. I told her, thank you. Got home.
Was it transitioning back home once you made it back home?
It was hard to get used to the food. Yeah, my stomach was always hurting because the food was so rich, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, sea rations are the same 7 meals for a whole year, you know. And then started eating food again, real food. And it took me a while to get used to it. My first night, I was restless. I used to sleep at night in the bush with a knife. Because I carried a machine gun, I couldn't have an M16 over my chest, sleeping with it. So I had a knife I slept with. And when I got home, I could not sleep without my knife. I always slept with it under my pillow and always had it in my hand. But the first night, I woke up. Next morning, my oldest brother showed up, jumped on me, scared the crap out of me. I knocked him on the ground. I had the knife to his throat. My knife was razor sharp. That's all I ever do, just sharpen, sharpen, sharpen it. And I left a knife mark across his neck, just like a little razor cut. And my mom walked in, and she said, "What's wrong with you?" She says, "What happened to you?" And I started crying.
Yeah.
You know, excuse me.
No, I understand. Kleenex or anything? I'm sorry. Yeah.
It was hard to get used to being home.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. But I was happy to be home. First Sunday, went to Mass. I had my uniform on. I was in the back of the church. And on the road, a car backfired on me. That backfired. Guess where I went?
Yeah.
I was on the ground. Habit, you know. I was on the ground and I was so embarrassed. I walked out, walked home. And I think that was the last time I had my uniform on.
Yeah. And what job did you get? Was it difficult finding work or?
Well, we were told before we left Washington that we would not have to work if we didn't want for 6 months, that we'd get unemployment. Mm-hmm. I said, "Oh, good, fine." And besides, you know, I was still recovering from my wounds.
Yeah.
And I went and applied for Social Security and everything. And the girl asked me, "Are you going to work?" I says, "No, ma'am, I'm not. I just got home from Nam. We're entitled to 6 months, to recover from our service. And I don't have to work. I could pull unemployment for 6 months without having to look for work." Well, 2 weeks later, I get a letter saying they denied my Social Security. I got so mad. I took my medals, I took my uniform, went back to the Social Security office and started screaming. And I threw my uniform, my medals at the people in there. And
what was
walked.
The response?
Well, they called the police, but I happened to leave before they showed up. A week later, they came in. The main person from Social Security there in Oxnard, where we live, about a little bit, 20 miles away, came to my house with my uniform pressed, my medals in a glass case, my checks for unemployment, and an apology. To have the girl that denied me, and she said she didn't know. That's okay. But they apologized, she apologized, I got my checks, and I was 6 months unemployment.
And then what did you end up doing after that?
There was a special program for vets, for jobs, and there was big companies, a gas company, Edison, which is electrical, phone companies. So I applied for all of them, and actually got a response from all three, the gas company, the Edison, and the phone company. The phone company was the first one that responded back to me. It asked me if I wanted a job. And I said, yes, I had a job. And then I've been with the phone company since for 37 and a half years.
Now, how did you reconnect with some of the men you served with?
Jim DeWitt mostly was the first one. I would call, talked to all the guys, but Jim and I were the tightest, besides Mike Allen, which was my machine gun assistant.
Okay.
So were you
in touch with Jim over the years?
Over the years,
time before you talked to each other?
Yeah, just over the years. I mean, we talked more than several times a year. Christmas, we always sent Christmas cards with our family pictures back and forth, back and forth. I watched his kids grow up through the mail, and he saw mine.
That's nice.
Yeah.
Is there one, before we wrap up, is there anything you'd like, future generations to kind of know about what it's like to be a soldier in the U.S. military?
Just to understand what we went through and don't protest us, Because I didn't get my welcome home until Sacramento. They had a dedication for a statue for the nurses. They had a couple of nurses holding a wounded man. Mm-hmm. And Jim DeWitt flew down from Chicago, and I drove up to Sacramento, and it was the biggest gathering of vets I've ever seen. And that was great. That, to me, that was my first homecoming. You know, before, you know, I just try not, I didn't talk about it very much. Yeah. You know.
Well, thanks so much for sharing your story this afternoon.
You're welcome.
Yeah. All right. Thanks.